ICAR sugar subcommittee and the direct board reports and the evidences presented to the direct board for the protection of sugar industry. What I am looking in this paper is at three focal points how Western sciences influence production process in sugar industry, majorly at three levels. First is the development of improved varieties of seeds, which were the high yielding varieties, which involved a lot of capital, more capital expenditure, initial expenditure than the earlier indigenous varieties. The other is the indigenous process of cultivation, which was the process of ripening. And the third is the production of indigenous commodities, which is gold and khansari. So the sugar industry in India was a small peasant commodity till 20th century. The main commodities were gold and khansari, or desi chini, as it was popularly known. The capital outlay was fairly small, and peasants produced the commodity by themselves without much outside intervention. The cane varieties were of indigenous nature. The white crystallized sugar consumed in India was mainly imported from Java and Cuba. In the 1920s, around 1 million tons of crystallized sugar was imported from these countries. The major consumers of this sugar were people from the higher end of the economic order. The people in the lower rung consumed gur and desi chini as it was cheaper, and gur, apart from being a sweetening agent, also served as an article of food. In order to offset the loss because of the import of sugar as it was from outside the British Empire, the colonial government sought to develop the Indian sugar industry on modern lines, that is, with science and technology. The main thrust of this development, as we would see later, was the use of scientific and technological tools to place Indian sugar industry in a competitive position with Japanese sugar. This happened not just at the expense of indigenous sugar varieties, but also at the expense of cultivators, though the stated agenda of the government was to help the sugarcane grower in getting higher returns. The most important intervention of the government for the development of sugar industry was the establishment of the Sugarcane Trading Institute in Coimbatore in 1912 under the Madras government, that was later brought under central control. The main function of the station was to collect as many varieties as possible and work for their acclimatization under local conditions and obtain crosses between thick tropical varieties and thin non-Indian varieties. The Indian Sugar Committee of 1920, commenting on the work done at the breeding station, stated, "The work done to evolve improved varieties of cane for Upper India, which will withstand the indifferent usage of the ordinary cane grower, should be abandoned as impracticable, and instead the work should focus on improved varieties involving better cultivation techniques." Clearly, the sugar committee was of the opinion that improved cane varieties that would give higher yield per acre should be the focus of cane breeding institute, although the terms of reference of the committee was to suggest methods to improve production either by factory production or through improvement in existing indigenous methods. It required higher capital outlay in terms of increased manuring and irrigation. This insistence for developing higher yielding varieties for sugarcane was clearly because the reference point for all the institutions of government was the yield of sugarcane in major sugar producing countries like Cuba and Java. The committee thought it was majorly through improving yields that industry could compete with imported sugar. It stated that the per capita yield in India during the year 1980 and 1990 was 107 tons, whereas in Cuba it was 196 tons. The sugar committee also suggested that the demonstration of improved varieties should increase, more demonstration farms should be opened, and existing ones should be expanded. The production of sugarcane with the use of improved varieties continued to grow, and it showed a marked increase in yield. The tariff board that came up with its report on giving protection to the sugar industry stated that since the output of sugarcane was more than what would be used in the production of wood and other indigenous commodities, there was a need to find an outlet for the surplus sugarcane. In order to assist the sugarcane grower in finding an outlet for the surplus sugarcane, the board suggested to increase the import duty on sugar from Java to stop the inflow of foreign sugar and develop modern sugar industry in India as a productive measure. The government increased the import duty so as to make it a productive one. It resulted in drastically reducing the import of sugar and proportional rise in the production of white sugar in India. The number of sugar factories rose exponentially, mainly in the United Province. Another result of this was that cane that was used for the production of gold too was directed for the factories. This increased the dependence of cane growers on the factories to buy their sugar cane, a position very often misused by the factory owners. It has been shown very extensively by Shaitan in how the cane the factory used many means to extract and give very low prices for the cane delivered to the factory. It also resulted in the dislocation of the sugar industry, as its rate of growth in the same period after production showed marked decrease. The net the only outlet not left for the cane growers, especially in eastern UP, not Bihar, where majority of the factories were located, was to supply their cane to the factories as way for the production of wood, light in disuse. The discursive paradigm during this period was that efficiency of sugarcane and its products was measured in terms of its sucrose content and recovery rate, as could be seen in all contemporary official documents. With this measure, the production of indigenous cane varieties and also the production of wood and kansai was considered as wasteful and inefficient, as its sucrose content and recovery rate was lower than improved varieties and factory-made white sugar. This explains the reason why the effort was taken by the government to organize the wood industry, and there was increased incidence of excise duty on kansari sugar that severely hit the industry. Even though the importance of research and development of indigenous process was realized in the official circles, as the problems of wood and kansari were peculiar to India and thus more attention should be given to it than has been given. And the sugar technology stated, the plant and processes used in the factory industry in India are similar to those used in other cane growing countries. They are the products of long research and experience of several countries. The problem of factory industry peculiar to India, and the necessity for scientific research is correspondingly less. Whereas for indigenous and wood industry, there is no parallel or counterpart in any other country of the world. In this branch of the industry, therefore, India is deprived of the benefit of the researches and accumulated experience of foreign workers, which it gets in factory industry. There is similar difficulty in regard to machinery for the indigenous industry. The foreign machinery makers have no idea of the special requirements of this industry, and consequently the machinery supplied to them is not always suitable. Another important aspect of this peculiar position is that the people who have to use this machinery have limited means, so the machinery should have low initial cost, which is not the case with supplied machinery. The development and distribution of improved varieties were not for the peasants to choose as they wish and do away with it if they did not want to. In reality, the government took an active role in making sure that the improved varieties continue to exist. In 1937, the provincial governments in UP and Bihar passed the Bihar and United Provinces Sugar Factories Control Act. The bill for the United Provinces stated, the occupier of the factory or any other person acting on his behalf shall not distribute seed cane of any variety to any person to be used by cane growers or members of the cane growers' cooperative societies if the governor, after consulting the board, has by an order published in the Gazette, declared that such varieties of seed cane is unsuitable for distribution to cultivators. It also stated that additional price was to be paid for special varieties of sugar cane. The result of production with the active involvement of the government in propagating improved varieties of sugar cane resulted in marked increase in both acreage under cane and acreage under improved varieties. In terms of acreage, it showed an increase from remaining in the range of 3 million acres from 1917 to 1931 to around 4 million acres by 1937. But more marked was the increase in the acreage under improved varieties. While it was 870,000 acres in 1931, it reached 3341,000 acres in the season of 1936-37, a fourfold increase. Yield per acre during the same period increased from 2.3 to 5.6 tons. The first major negative effect of the increase in the production of sugarcane was felt in the 1936-37 season. The tariff board gave the reason for the crisis as, after the outbreak of Abyssinian War in September 1935, speculation buying of sugar took place. At the same time, internal production was increasing rapidly, so increase in internal production was not offset by decrease in imports. The increase in internal stock led to nervousness in the market for clearing up of stocks and was evident from the end of 1936. It led to fall in prices as factories were competing with each other for clearing up their stocks. According to the tariff board, there were two major developments that contributed to the crisis. First was the announcement to raise the excise duty in February 1937 by 8 annas. The expectation was that it would increase in the price of sugar, but after initial rise in price, it again continued to decline as factories, in order to evade payment of additional duty, began clearing of their stocks. It also accentuated nervousness in the market, with the traders refusing to buy stocks on new terms. The second factor was the decision of sugar factories in UP and Bihar to prolong crushing season at the insistence of governments of UP and Bihar with a reduced rate of cane. The effect of this whole scene on the price was that the price of sugarcane reached to rupees 6 per mound in Kanpur by June 1937, as opposed to rupees 8 in the previous season. This was only partial explanation to the crisis. The production of cane had been higher than what was required for the factories, and was little more than previous seasons. The board estimated that the production exceeded consumption by 31,000 tons in 1935-36 and 53,000 tons in 1936-37. The impact of this overproduction would have been more serious had the factories not prolonged their crushing at the insistence of the governments of UP and BR, though at reduced rates. Even then, large quantity of cane remained wasted at the fields. The crisis of 1936-37 prompted mixed response. Thus, the trial board was clear in its opinion that state intervention for the rationalization of the industry was necessary and the production of cane has to be reduced. It also suggested that the minimum price for cane should be just enough for the cultivator to continue production, but it should not induce him to increase acreage. The factories that were already giving low price for the peasants reduced the prices further to discourage the producer from giving more cane. The cultivator's predicament was that, despite the low cost he received from his cane, he continued to grow it as it provided him the cash required to pay his rent. The Department of Education, Health and Lands was of the opinion that both sides of the industry should be strengthened, as it then becomes non-perishable, so it gives more time for refining, thus allowing more bargaining power to the agriculturalists. The insistence on improved varieties, however, continued. Agricultural expert of the ICAR gave the estimate of the entrenchment of the new varieties and stated that between 1929-30 to 1936-37, the indigenous varieties have been replaced by improved varieties, the average being 75%, and in some places, improved varieties covered as much as 90% of the cane area. Different varieties of cane were chosen as early, middle and late ripening varieties to prolong the crushing season. The achieved crushing season was said to be from mid-November to mid-May. The UP government went forward to pass a law to declare the cultivation of certain varieties of cane illegal. It was done with a view to make varieties with low sugar content and make therefore newly improved varieties. The crisis of the industry from overproduction resulting in glut in the market and crashing of stocks continued for successive years. In order to insulate themselves from this cycle, factories of UP and BR formed a select organization called the Indian Sugar Syndicate. It decided the quota wages for individual factories and their selling price. The result of the formation of this syndicate was that it created artificial prices of sugar by withholding stocks and increasing the price of sugar. The government controlled the situation by taking over the function of the marketing of sugar and quota releases, thus stabilizing the prices. It was clear that with the issue of overproduction and glut in the sugar market emerging, the marketing structure was revisited by the government at various levels. The other issues concerning overproduction were also reassessed, like the agri and the cane, the minimum prices given to the cultivators. One aspect of production that was not discontinued but given further thrust by the state was research and development of improved varieties of cultivation, with improved varieties of cane being the focus of cane development and research, as was the case from the time cane breeding center came into existence. The other existing practice that was described and criminalized was the system of ratooning. It meant cultivating the same sets for two or more seasons. This was very popular practice in the United Provinces because of its cheapness. In order to discourage it, agricultural departments came up with mixed responses. One of which, amongst which the most vivid attempt to get away with this practice came from United Provinces, where it was stated that the agriculture department was asking the revenue department to refuse water to ratoon cane for more than 1 year. The Bihar government responded by saying that, in our opinion, ratooning of sugar cane should in general be discouraged until such time that the cultivator has fully realized the importance of clean culture and has extensively adopted the improved methods of cultivation and maneuvering. The low yields and, what is far more important, the harboring of insect pests and fungus diseases is largely due to the ratoon crop not receiving proper attention with regards to cultivation. Suitability of the variety and environment under which ratooning is practiced. For instance, low-lying, badly drained, flooded or light soil areas should never be allowed to go under ratoons, as it is here that the troubles are augmented. At present, the policy of this department is to discourage ratooning through this propaganda staff until such time as the Bihar cultivator has adopted the art of growing sugarcane properly. The committee of entomologists, however, declared that ratooning does not increase the incidence of pests. So there were certain aspects of production introduced by the colonial government, like the establishment of the superiority of improved varieties of seeds developed at the sugarcane breeding station. It termed certain processes of sugar manufacture, like the manufacture of wood and kansai, as wasteful, giving the logic of sucrose content and recovery rate. The most stark example of the aversion for indigenous production process could be seen in the case of ratooning, where even though there was no scientific evidence to suggest that rattling increases the incidence of cane pests and insect pests, cane diseases and insect pests, the colonial state wanted to penalize those who practice it. Now, this is one aspect of the story. The argument, the other is the capital argument, where one reason for propagating and supporting the modern manufacture of sugar was the trade structure of the government, where most of the machinery that was imported from, that was used in the modern factories, was imported from mainly from Britain. So it was the agency houses like the Baxter Ireland and Company and other agency houses which directed this course of development with the help of the government.